So I recently ordered a bunch of prints to hang on the walls here in the studio, make this place feel special, and I shared about it over on Instagram. Well, lo and behold, there were a ton of questions that came flooding in all about what do you need to know when you are printing work? What are the details in terms of file types and color space and paper printing process? So that's exactly what we're gonna answer here in this video here today. We're gonna dig into all the nitty gritty details, and I've enlisted the help of an expert, a printer, to make sure that next time you are ordering prints, you're printing work, that what you see on the screen is what shows up in the mail. Hey there, I'm Joni Simon, food photographer. Welcome to my studio. Like I mentioned, today we're going to talk about what you need to know before you print your work. What are those important details from export settings and different types of paper and printing process? We're going to get into it. And this is relevant, of course, if you are doing work for clients that's intended to be printed, but also, you know, printing for personal use. You know, for me, over the years, I've printed a lot of work for gifts at the holidays. You know, I'll be definitely placing some orders soon. Like my Nana, she loves a new photo of the great grandkids for her desk. And my mom has her ever expanding wall of photos of the grandkids. She's also, you know, over the years, there's different images that I take that she's like, oh, I just love that one. Like this one of these roses. She loved that photo. So I went and ordered a big print for her. There was last year at her birthday, she had a brand new puppy. I borrowed the puppy and took photos of it. Muffin's adorable. And I will tell you that this image, I did post it to my Instagram, which of course is a food Instagram account, but this image of Muffin ended up being by far the most liked, most popular image on my entire Instagram, which I guess I get it. It's a cute dog. I will say though, I'm not going into dog photography anytime soon. We're sticking to the food. But when I went to go order the prints here in the studio, I of course wanted to make sure I went with a quality printer and was just curious what was out there, did some research and came across Printique. And so I went ahead and ordered a 16 by 20 on fine art paper. You know, I had a pretty good feeling that things were gonna turn out well, but wanted to just do kind of one round before I committed to a whole series of 7 photos. And so that first one showed up and it was beautiful. Colors were spot on, crisp and clear. I was super happy. So I ended up ordering the rest of my prints for the studio through Printique, and I definitely recommend them to anybody. And so that's what, of course, I did. I shared on Instagram about my experience, then connected directly with the folks at Printique, who they were excited about what we're doing here on the Bite Shot. And so I'm also excited to share with you that today's video is sponsored by Printique. Now, if you head on over to their website, you can check out everything they have to offer. Of course, you've got those standard prints and lots of different options for prints, you know, not just on paper. You can also do it, for example, on metal, like I did with this photograph of my son Calvin with my mother-in-law. This is actually her sled from when she was a little girl. So I have this old photograph and I thought, oh, this would be a perfect Christmas gift. So printed this on a small metal print. Don't tell her, she's gonna get it for Christmas this year. You can also order in acrylic, which is a pretty cool way to go because then you don't have to frame the work, like these little acrylic blocks. You can give those as a gift that somebody can keep right on their desk. But of course, I was a fan of and customer of Printique before they sponsored this video. So certainly if you are looking to order prints, you wanna give some special gifts that are uniquely your own this holiday season, go check out Printique.com. But the other really cool thing that they helped me out with was this video, because of course, all those great questions came in through Instagram about printing details. And you know, I felt like I knew a lot when it came to printing, but I didn't know everything. So I was super happy to have their expertise as a printer, somebody who does this every single day, to weigh in on the questions you submitted. And I'll tell you, I learned a couple things. So let's get into it. So question number one, and this by far was the most popular question frequently asked, was what color space should I use in terms of that final file? What should I export it as? So if you're familiar with, in most standard cameras, we've got 2 options when it comes to color space. That's the array of colors that are being captured. And we have either Adobe RGB 1998, or we have sRGB. And likewise, we have various different options when we go export from Lightroom or Capture One, Photoshop. When we think of sRGB, that is typically going to be the option for the internet. Now, interestingly enough, enough, and this is also backed up by what I hear from when I work with printers on cookbooks and things like that, is they request for the images in sRGB. And maybe you're thinking, well, why don't they want the Adobe RGB 1998? That's a bigger, wider color array. Well, what the folks at Printique had to say was that sRGB tends to be the standard for both printing and the internet. So it gives the most accurate and consistent colors from camera to monitor to print. It's the safe option. Now to expand on that, they say, yes, Adobe RGB gives a larger color space. However, it's compressed, and if it's not properly converted, the colors can look drab or dull on the internet and in print, and you may have seen this happen. So you can always shoot in Adobe RGB and then convert into sRGB and export. So I always keep my camera in the Adobe RGB. Of course, also shooting in RAW is going to give you all of those color options, but when you export the file, export it in sRGB. Now, the caveat to all of this, when you're working with a client, their printer may have particular specs, but the folks at Printique, they're offering this as sort of like the wide, generally applicable information that you can use in most situations. But if you have a client and their printer says, we need this very specific thing, then give them that very specific thing. But when I upload the images to Printique to print my work, I'm uploading that in sRGB. So question number two, and this is still kind of in the same context of talking about color, that how do you know that what you see on the screen is what's actually going to show up when your prints arrive at your doorstep? So one of the things that they recommend just keeping in mind is the idea that when we look at our images on a computer, its light is coming in from behind the colors, that all of those colors are based on the combination of red, green, and blue, RGB, as opposed to images that are printed by a printer are printed applied to paper. There's no light coming through behind. The light is reflecting off of. And those are printed from a combination of CMYK, so cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. So just something to keep in the back of your mind, that the way that images look on a monitor versus the way that they look in print, they will differ, that printers and monitors operate differently and display colors in a different manner. But that being said, there's definitely some best practices that help in ensuring that that translation from monitor to the page goes well. So the first one being making sure that you are regularly calibrating your monitor. For me, this is a regular practice. If you have not calibrated your monitor before, you're not sure where to start, I do have a previous video on that entire process. It's actually super duper easy. It's actually kind of fun and nifty. This ensures that then when you are soft proofing those images, looking at those images on your monitor, that's what we call soft proofing, that those colors are accurate, that your monitor isn't skewing towards one color or another. For example, whenever I calibrate my monitor, it's like the reds just always sort of drift off and they're just never quite right. So it's really helping to ensure that everything is properly aligned, properly calibrated, so that what you're seeing on the screen is accurate. And then the second thing that you can do is actually move forward with a test print called hard proofing, where we actually order prints to see, is the color accuracy there? Are we getting what we're looking for? And so you don't necessarily have to order like the full final thing. Like, especially this to me is important in situations where we're ordering something very large or something very expensive or something very important that we want to last a long time, that accuracy is super important. I mean, you may not do this for greeting cards, for example, but something where there's some significant importance to it, then doing that hard proofing step, ordering, say, for example, some 8x10s on standard paper, and then seeing how do those look? Is that color accuracy there? Do we need to make tweaks and changes? Now, the folks over at Printique, they also offer color correction. So if you just click that on, then they can run through the color correction process on their end. But if you want total control over it, you don't want them to touch it, then you make sure not to click that box. So question number three, again, definitely a frequently asked question, is what do we need in terms of resolution of the image? And if you're not familiar with what resolution even is, what that means, I have a previous video that kind of breaks down the numbers of taking the number of megapixels, taking the measurements of an image, and understanding what is its resolution. So if you haven't checked that one out, you need some of that help, go check that out. It's linked down below. But the recommended export setting when we are setting those settings in Lightroom or Capture One or Photoshop is selecting 300 ppi, 300 pixels per inch, which in print terms translates to 300 dots per inch. So for every inch of that image, there's gonna be 300 dots, and that's considered a high resolution image. And at 300 pixels per inch, that will come through as a crisp and a sharp and a clear image. Now, of course, you do wanna make sure that you actually have a big enough image in terms of like measuring the sides that it can have 300 pixels per inch, but we actually have a lot of leeway in that. So most standard DSLR cameras, 18 megapixels, 24 megapixels, and so on and so forth onward, are plenty big enough in order to capture that 300 ppi. Now, sometimes you might see thrown around there the idea of 72 ppi, but that is specifically for the internet. And if you export an image at 72 ppi and then go to print it, it is not going to be as sharp and crisp and clear. There's just not as many dots there. So if you want those super crispy and clear photos, 300 ppi. So question number four is, are there any special considerations when it comes to editing our images for print versus for the internet? Do we have to do anything differently? And the good answer is no, we don't have to. It's the same sort of considerations for print as is for the web. Now, that being said, one of the things that I'm especially mindful of when images are being printed is to pay attention to the highlights and to the shadows, which I do for the web, but I'm especially mindful of it for printed work because we want to make sure that we're not overexposing those highlights or underexposing the shadows, that we're not losing the detail, that there have been situations in the past, one of the early cookbooks that I photographed, a couple images were sent back to me to fix because they were underexposed in the shadows, that we lost the detail in the shadows. So I needed to bring up the brightness there, bring up the exposure. Now, that being said, one thing that I wanna, you know, tell you is that you also, though there is creative license and there's freedom to do what you desire, that if you have a lot of specular highlights in something, some really bright highlights that are definitely blown and overexposed, that's okay. You can absolutely do that. That's totally personal preference. I do, though, make sure to be mindful that the key subjects and the important elements of the image are fully visible by not over or underexposing them. Now, if you're not familiar with the concept of your clipped highlights or your clipped shadows and the idea of the histogram and how to read that information, I'll link some helpful information down below for you. So the next question is, should I sharpen for printing? And this is, you know, something that's kind of a tricky answer because there's not necessarily a one straight away, clear, defined, like here's what you should do in every single situation because it will greatly depend. But the thing to be mindful of in the sharpening department and sort of a telltale sign of some amateur photography, if we're being honest, is over sharpened images. A little bit of sharpening can go a long way. Adding a little bit of sharpness to help really boost that clarity factor and boost the sharpness factor, but not so much because you get to a certain point where definitely on the web, on a display, you can see things when they're over sharpened, it just looks way too crispy. But then that becomes exacerbated and even worse when we go to print the image. So I don't wanna make you shy away from sharpening things, but definitely a recommendation to play around with it and just be mindful of. And this is too something that you will attune your eye to more over time, but some basic sharpening can really help to make that image look super crispy when you print it. So question number five is, when it comes to cropping and formatting, how do I know what's gonna be in the image or what's gonna be cut off? I know this was a question that I had a lot early on, like what am I gonna lose in this image when it gets printed? So first key factor is to pay attention to the aspect ratio that you're working with. So say for example, you have shot your image on a full frame camera that is capturing images at a 2:3 aspect ratio. And then you go into Printique and you go to put together your order and you're like, oh, I wanna order 8:10s and 4:5s and so on and so forth. And I know like early days before I was a photographer, I would get those images, I'd upload them, I'd print them and I'd be like, why is everybody's tops of their heads cut off, right? Because I didn't think about the fact that the aspect ratios didn't line up. So just make sure that if you're ordering a 4:5, that the file is a 4:5, or just be prepared for a crop to happen. And of course you can adjust for that crop once you've uploaded those images to be ordered, but being mindful of what is the desired aspect ratio of the final image and potentially cropping that in your editing process so that it's a direct translation. And of course, a great general rule is to shoot a little bit wider than you need. So you have that ability in post to crop in. You can always crop in, you can't uncrop. I mean, you can do some Photoshop work, but ultimately giving yourself a little bit of breathing room when you shoot it so that then you can crop in post. And of course too, if you shoot tethered like I do, you have the option for other overlays when you're capturing the image. So if you know kind of from the get-go, oh, we want this printed as an 8x10, then making sure that we are overlaying that aspect ratio so that when we're capturing the image, we're making sure all the important features and things that are in the scene are captured inside that 8x10 aspect ratio. So question number 6, this is a great question in terms of terminology. I've heard the term full bleed before. What does that mean? So full bleed is the idea that the image completely extends from edge to edge, as opposed to being printed in such a way where we have a white border around it. You may have seen that. Instead, full bleed goes all the way to the edges. And so when we print in full bleed, you have to be mindful of the fact that that image is then going to be trimmed. They're going to trim the edges of it. And that trim then means we are going to lose portions of that edge up to around 1/8 of an inch typically. This though will vary depending on the printer, on the product, so definitely be mindful if you're printing full bleed to pay attention to any notes about what is that trim factor and what you may lose. So if you're worried about something's being printed full bleed and you're worried about losing the edges, just make sure to keep things outside of that 1/8 inch margin on the edges, keeping everything inside of that, and you'll be safe. And the extra little helpful note that the folks that Printique included with this is that this is especially important for portrait photography, where you want to make sure fingers, toes, tops of heads do not get cut off in the printing process. Now, that being said, though, you may shoot something with some sort of important detail flush along the edge of the image, in which case you're going to want to make a selection where that image is not printed as full bleed, where you do end up with some sort of border, or you do some sort of extension of the background in Photoshop. So just be mindful what's happening on the edges. Are we printing this full bleed? What may we be losing in that trim process? So question number 7, and this one, I learned something. This was super helpful and makes so much sense of the variation and difference from the different qualities of printer. But the question was, does the type of printing process matter? And they say, yes, do your research. This is what the folks at Printique say. Printique is one of the few photography labs around that still uses the traditional technology to create prints and books. So the process is called silver halide printing. Silver halide photographic prints are printed using light sensitive paper and silver based chemistry. So kind of taking it back to the darkroom concept. The idea is that the paper is exposed to light and the image is infused into the paper through a chemical process. So we are physically bonding that image to the paper, as opposed to other images where we're using ink printing. So ink printing is where ink is applied on top of the paper. And so that's why there's been situations, I know I've done this before, like I've printed images at Costco, right? And then you're like, why is it a little hazy? Why does it feel not quite right? It's because the image has been printed with ink and it may have smudged or slightly shifted. And so you're not going to get that same clarity and precision that you would get with the silver halide process. And not only are you getting sharper images because you don't have ink shifting around, but also you're just going to get truer colors. You're going to get more accurate reproduction of skin tones and flesh, as well as more depth in the image. So when you really look at the difference of different printers, that printing process is really a key to the equation. All right, so next question, question number 8, I think. What kind of paper should I use? There are so many different options, right? And so the folks at Printique sort of gave me a really great rundown of the different general options that you'll find for most printers and which ones fit kind of best. So for printing food versus printing portraits, different styles, different feelings, different vibes. So for example, we have the Luster, which is definitely kind of a classic with rich colors. colors, you get kind of a little sort of textured component to the images. This is kind of like a personal favorite for me. I love sort of that classic feel. But if you're looking for something more contemporary, a little bit more modern, you go for that polished, glossy sort of look. I think we all know what glossy photos look like. To me, it's like high fashion, fabulous, right? But it also really reflects the light beautifully and shows off the colors. Now for me, for the prints that I have here in the studio, I really wanted the richness and the depth of those images communicated. So I went with the matte. To me, that matte paper really had a great ability to communicate the feeling that I was looking for in my images. There's little to no reflection, so you're really kind of seeing the image as it is in its truest sense. So this is definitely kind of like that pro level, right? Like, you're not hiding anything in a matte photo. Now, one interesting note from the folks at Printique is that the matte finish is not recommended for anything with dense shadows or rich blacks. So if you are intentionally crushing the blacks, you know, kind of really going really dark on those shadows, that matte may not be the best finish because you're not going to get as much of that sharp contrast and that punch that you would get out of the glossy or the luster. Now, if you have something that is super special and you want to treat it like it's a fine art piece and we need archival quality, they also offer that as well. Look for the giclée option. Or maybe you're looking to make a statement or you want something, you know, that you don't have to frame. Then you have other options like printing on wood or metal or the acrylics or canvas. Again, go check out all the options over at printique.com. So as a follow-up to that, the question of does the selection of paper have an impact on the way that the images are going to look? And absolutely yes, that the selection of matte, for example, may not be the best for something with really deep, dark blacks and moody contrast. That may be something better intended for luster or glossy. And so yet another compelling reason for that hard proofing process, especially if these are images that you're printing that are very important or very large, something you really want to make sure that has a very specific look, that hard proofing process is going to really help in making that appropriate selection. So then question number 9, which came across, but now we've already talked about, is the question of, is test printing a thing? Is that something I can do? And the folks at Printique said, absolutely, this is something we're happy to help you out with. Just contact their customer service to get yourself all set up, that they will help you, coach you through that process, make sure you have what you need. And that is definitely something that I'm going to encourage, that even though you have all this information and understanding the sRGB and the file types and the resolution, like you have that information now, but it's always important taking that next additional step to ask for help from the folks who do this every day. There's a reason that great customer service is important when it comes to printing. So the folks at Printique will definitely take good care of you and help answer all those questions so that once you do get those final prints that you feel really great about it. And the same goes for working with a printer, with a client, that I'm always asking questions and that we're testing things out and delivering files and making sure it's going to work and that it's going to fulfill the vision that they have, that they're able to play around with that too. So you don't have to be an expert in this stuff, but you do have to ask questions. And I'm super excited now for you to go print some work. I really have to recommend you do that. If you've never printed your work before, there's something really special about an image that you've created and actually holding it in your hands, putting it on the wall. It's a really amazing feeling. Now, one other cool thing about Printique, and this is specifically if you have ever thought about selling your prints online, is that they have a very easy way that you can do that through Printique, selling your images through your Squarespace site. So it's actually how I came across Printique in the first place, is thebiteshot.com is built on Squarespace, and I was kind of toying around with the idea of selling some of my prints through my website, and lo and behold, Squarespace has a connection on the back end to Printique that you can just set up a gallery over at Printique and kind of make the selections of what sizes and what types of mediums and paper and all that jazz, and then easily set up a page then on your Squarespace site to sell those prints. So I actually have opened up a print shop. If you have ever wanted to purchase one of my prints to hang on your wall or give as a gift, you can do that now. But almost more importantly than that, you can create an additional revenue stream for yourself by selling your prints online. So you can check out all the details. I'll link that information down below. But if you have a Squarespace site, this is especially easy and doesn't take a lot of time to set up. As an added little footnote, recent new announcements client from Printique that their Printique Pro Service, which was developed to empower creators, now offers a new pro loyalty pricing program, which I've got information about that link down below, but it is a part of the overall suite of features that they offer designed to help you sell more, increase your bottom line, protect your work, and they are putting your business at the center of what they do. But now maybe there were some questions that you still have that weren't answered. Feel free to use the comment section below. We'll try to answer as many of those as we can for you. But thank you so much to the folks at Printique for sponsoring today's video. I know that I'm going to be hopping on there soon to order some holiday prints for some family members. But with that, thank you for watching. I hope you stay out of trouble, and then I'll see you soon, all right? Bye!